Hey guys, welcome back to Striking Studies. So today we'll be doing the story of Village Palampur part 2. So this video's main topic is just going to be distribution of land between the farmers of Palampur. So in case you're wondering what that extremely awkward, weird picture is, it's supposed to be showing land with a big no symbol. So it's like representing no land for the one-third landless farmers of Palampur. Now, like I already said, one-third of them are landless, and the total population is just 450 families. And then 240 of the families have small plots of land, and they're called small farmers. 60 families have medium and large, and the rest have large farmers. So, this picture at the bottom is like a depiction of how much land exactly does each person get. Small farmers mostly get lesser than that, but I really do not know what to do with the excess space, so I ended up putting small farmer there. So, farming, now we have all the farms. One person or even family cannot do the whole field, especially if you're a medium or large farmer. So the medium and large farmers get farm laborers who are either landless farmers or who have very less farmland with them. So these people come work for the large and medium farmers, and they actually get a very low wage, or they get something in return, like a bit of fruits, vegetables, food, anything. So the wages of the workers vary and from region to region and crop to crop, and there's a wide variation in duration of employment because farming is like a seasonal activity in most areas. So if you're a farm laborer, you only get work during time busy seasons like sowing, harvesting, threshing, or something like that. You don't get it when the crop's just standing there and growing. So it is the other part time they'll just be unemployed and just sitting waiting for the crops to grow quick. Now, if you want to grow crops, you need money. You need money to buy seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, what not, what yes, whatever. And so most of the small farmers borrow money from moneylenders or traders to arrange capital. And these people charge really high rate of interest to the farmer. But the large and medium farmers have their own savings from the previous year's farming. Then the medium and large farmers are also smart when they go to the bank and get a loan where the interest is not that high. So this is like an important supply chain thing, and I think it's better if I explain it in a flowchart. So let's make it a flowchart. 3, 2, 1, flowchart. Okay, so we'll start with the first of all, the crop is grown and then it's supplied to the market. And by market, I don't mean the market where we go and buy, but it's a big market where traders buy from. And then these traders go and sell it to shopkeepers in towns, cities, and villages. And then the farmers get money from the sale, right? So most of it they use for them, for their family food and other essentials, and the remainings are kept as savings for the next crop, because for the working capital of the next crop, because you know, working capital, you need to keep working to get it, like seeds. Okay, and that's what I said. Yeah, and if you save for a lot of time, you might even be able to increase your fixed capital, like trucks, cattle, tractors, I don't know what else, what not. And that's the end of part 2. This was a short video because it was a short part, but that's all for today. If you like this video, don't forget to like it, subscribe, and share, and comment down below how this video is. You can also comment down if you have any doubts. Bye guys.